Wait, and also from Sarah Rodstill. Anything else, anybody else? Add any apologies now? Cherry Bowen as well, Council Cherry Bowen. Thanks for that. Okay, item one on the agenda is Members' Code of Conduct, Declarations of Interest. Are there any declarations of interest members want to make?
If I may, Chair, it's not an amendment to the minutes. I wasn't present at the meeting, but I don't think so. It says I wasn't. Can't remember that far back. And there's no other opportunity for me to say this, but I would just like to say how I'd like to, perhaps members can back me on this, but I'd like to pass a thanks on to former Councillor Paul Dougherty for his excellent chairing this committee the last few years. I don't recall whether it was 4 years, I'm not really sure. It seems to have passed by very quickly. But if members are agreeable, I would hope we could pass a vote of thanks to former Councillor Paul Dougherty.
Absolutely.
Yeah, in fairness, at the last meeting, that was actually. But I'm more than happy to do it again and to formally, as Chair, endorse those comments. I appreciate they're big boots to fill, so, but I think we're all very grateful to Paul for all the work he's done on the conventions. And I'm personally grateful for the advice he's given to me in advance of tonight's meeting as well. So more than happy to have that minute. Okay, item three, we need to appoint a vice chair for the forthcoming municipal year. I'm very happy to nominate Councillor George Davies as vice chair of the pension committee. Would anybody like to second that? Tony's happy to second that. Are we all okay to endorse George as vice chair of the committee? Thanks very much, George, stepping up for that. And just one other comment on that item three is the representation at the pooling meeting that take place between ourselves and our colleagues from Greater Manchester and West Yorkshire. That I've discussed this with the chief officer, and the suggestion is that any of the party spokespersons are welcome to attend the pooling meetings. The only constraint as such is that there's a maximum of two of us can attend. So in due course when the meetings come up, perhaps people can circulate that. And if people would like to attend, maybe if you could inform myself and Peter. And if there's a queue, we'll just have to sort it out handily. Is that okay? Okay, lovely, thank you. Right, item four is the audit findings report on pages 7 to 22.
Yes, thank you, Chair. My name is Cllr Pat Cleary. I'm the engagement lead for the audit. I'm responsible for issuing the audit opinion on the financial statements, and I'm joined tonight by Stuart Bassinet, the audit manager. And we'll look to take you briefly through the audit findings report. Just in terms, I suppose, for members of my community, the committee, in terms of the process overall, as auditors, or as Wirral Council is the administrative authority, and the pension fund accounts all part ultimately of Wirral's accounts. However, what we do as an audit firm is have teams that specialise in auditing pension funds, and hence myself as Stuart, well appointed to audit the pension fund. And the audit finding report you have today will come to you, and we treat report to you as being sort of the pensions. And audit finding report will also go to Wirral's Audit and Risk Committee, as ultimately they are who are considered those chartered governance in terms of signing off the council's accounts. So what we do is present to you tonight, and then I presume that you'll recommend agreement to AFR and proposal to accept pension. changes to the accounts. I can't, as you can see in the agenda adjustments, there's one or two, two matters bring to your attention. One is in relation to the classification change in relation to one set of assets moving from level two back to level one in relation to bond, so you can value them. And the other main change to the account is, as a pension fund, in terms of the way you report on the present value of retirement benefits, or present value of retirement benefits, you use what's called option C, which is you publish the actual statement. I'm sure members may be aware through their other contacts, through their other work, there's something called the McLeod judgment been going through the court in relation to an age discrimination case, which were primarily was the judges and the firefighter schemes. The government was looking to appeal that judgment, but it came out against them, it wasn't granted, and on that basis, the view is actually that it was also a statement from Liz Truss yesterday in relation to the government's response to that, which I suppose, in essence, if I paraphrase that, would be it accepts that there's going to be an increase in liabilities in all public service schemes, not just the firefighters and the judges. And as always, that they've approved it into the probable rather than the possible, and therefore, not so much we're expecting that the maybe employers perspective to look at the net pension liability and maybe and to change their accounts. Within the pension fund accounts, it's slightly different to say you have an actuarial statement, and what we have been looking for is actuaries to update that statement. You as a pension fund have gone to your actuary and they provided you an updated statement that then considers the impact of the power judgment. So that increases your liabilities or the credit by about 78 million, which is actually just below my materiality. Of course, as members are aware, whilst liability is impacted, what then falls through into council tax is part of actually the ongoing 2019 valuation that's going through now that will affect contribution rates for employers. So it is a big change in the disclosure notes in your accounts. So if I take you through now onto page 10 of the pack, that just explains how the approach, we've not had to change materiality or elements like that. And then in terms of page 11, when we put out plan, and then not all members would have been present at the time, we identified certain specific risks in relation with regard to revenue recognition, nothing has come to our attention to change that. We have to consider management override controls, that's me being a sceptical auditor, taking some manipulating your accounts. We've undertaken that work, I think we've now completed that work from journals, so we're comfortable. Area, and then also looking at level three evaluation, level three investments. So that sure wants to keep you up to date on where we are.
So the work is it's substantially complete for the majority of the investments. The approach is to obtain confirmation from investment managers and matter also the audit accounts to get some additional assurance of evaluations. And so whilst we've received that for all the investment confirmations, we're also waiting on some audit accounts from some investment managers, both ourselves and the fund are chasing them to try and get this through. But we've also put together a plan for some alternative procedures in order for us to get our assurance that way. So, like I said, at the time of writing, there's about 70% complete, probably more about 85 to 90% now. It's just a massive huge struggle to try and get through. But like I say, we have got sort of the alternative procedures plan in place. Yeah, and so level twos, that work is substantially complete. We've received all the information that we require for that. It's just a case of us processing the information we've received and completing our testing. So that again should be completed in the next few days.
So then just briefly, so moving on, I've already covered the McLeod judgment in my summary. We are part of going concern, I think as members are aware from a pension fund perspective, it's slightly different from maybe the employer's perspective in terms of we have to look at any issues that we consider that maybe the fund's going to wind out, and then clearly your statutory fund, but we have looked at cash flows and you have significant assets that would support your pension payments over a number of years. So overall we are satisfied that yes, there aren't no going concern issues I need to bring to your attention at this time. There are, in terms of other matters, in terms of what we have to do, we have to look at whether
the statement of accounts commence on page 68 of the pack. The value of the fund as at 31st of March 2019 is $8.9 million. I do not propose to go through the accounts at this meeting, but I'm happy to take any questions. The accounts have been subject to external audit over summer, and the previous item includes the findings of that review. The accounts were prepared and available for audit by the 31st of May in compliance with the statutory deadline for 2018-19 reporting. In response to the Grant Thornton report, officers have agreed to the suggested one adjustment to the disclosures, and there were no adjustments affecting the fund's reported financial position for the 31st of March 2019 of $8.9 million. Overall, the Grant Thornton report is a positive report and reflects the hard work undertaken by fund officers. 2.6, the report informs members that during the audit period, the fund obtained a revised actuarial statement of the value of retired benefits that reflects the McLeod position, and that updated actuarial statement is within the pack. 2.6 of this report informs members that the letter of representation has been prepared on behalf of this committee and gives assurances to the auditor on various aspects related to the pension fund. The letter will be signed by the Section 151 officer and the Chair of Audit and Risk Management Committee following that committee approving the financial statements, including the NLGPS accounts. Section 13 has the recommendations for Item 5. If we move on to Item 6, the purpose of this report is to provide members with the draft annual report of Merseyside Pension Fund for 2018-19. The LGPS regulations require the pension fund annual report to contain the fund account, the net asset statement, and the supporting notes and disclosures prepared in accordance with proper practices. International standards on auditing requires that auditors read any information published with the accounts. It also states that the auditor should not issue an opinion until the other information is published. The fund statements of accounts and the auditor's audit finding report, as just stated, are separate items on this agenda and provide additional assurance that the annual report has been subject to independent scrutiny. The recommendations for agenda item 6 is contained within section 13 of that report. I'm happy to take any questions, Chair, on either item 5 or item 6.
Thanks very much, Donna. Anybody want any clarification for any questions on items 5 or 6?
No,
or really that. Just endorse the comments I've made earlier about the hard work. All the hard work has gone into preparing the annual report. The committee is asked under item 5 to approve the audit statement of accounts for 2018-19, consider the amendments to the accounts, the audit findings report, and the letter of representation. And also, the pension committee refers the recommendations to the audit and risk management committee. Are we okay? And we're also asked on item 6 to approve the draft annual report. Can we take that as approved?
Agreed.
Thank you very much indeed. Okay, so Donna, you're up again for item 7, the budget outturn for 18-19 final budget.
Thank you, Chair. The purpose of this report is to request that members vote and approve the outturn for the financial year 2018-19. Finalised budget for the financial year 2019-20 and the 3-year budget for NPF as required for the annual report. Members will recall that Pensions Committee received a paper in January on the budget, and it was agreed that I would bring finalised figures to this meeting. The appendix of that reported in January is included as appendix 2 to this paper. The actual outturn for the last financial year and the finalised budget for the financial year for this financial year can be found as appendix 1 to this report. The actual outturn for 18-19 is $17.6 million, lower than the original approved budget of $22 million and lower than that projected outturn of $19.4 million as reported to committee in January. The lower figure is principally due to a quarter four sell-off in equity markets, which reduced investment management costs. The finalised budget for 2019-20 is $22.3 million. Section 2.3 of this report highlights to members the updates from that reported in January. Staffing now reflects updated salary and salary-related recharges, updated IT budget to reflect planned IT projects. There's been an updated actuary fees to reflect the valuation work 2.4 to 2.6 of this report details the three-year budget for MPF for inclusion in the 2018-19 annual report. As previously reported, CIFA's best practice for the contents of the financial performance report includes the three-year budget. Approval is sought to include the three-year budget in this year's annual report, although annual budgets will still be brought to Pensions Committee for approval. Section 2.7 reminds members that reduced costs and excellent value for money is a prudent criterion and acknowledges investment management fees are a significant element of the fund's costs. This section informs members that the fund and the Northern LGPS use CEM to benchmark investment management fees and examine these costs in the context of risk and return. The fund uses this information to ensure the effectiveness of the fund's expenditure in this key area. The benchmarking report for 2018-19 will be presented to a future IMWP. The recommendations for this item can be found in section 12. Happy to take any questions, Chair. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Donna. Any questions to Donna on item 7?
Service who aims just
car leases, that would be £95k exit cap, will reduce pension costs for affected employers, given that excess payments will now be capped. Separate administrative process will need to be implemented for those employers covered by the cap and those not covered. The recommendations are in section 13 of the report, but I'm happy to take any questions or any issues.
Yes, John, please.
Thanks, Chair. With regards to section 2.13, proposed models, would you not suggest, would you not agree that we currently operate under option 3 or something close to option 3 currently anyway in joint committee?
I would, but the joint committee has its constituted. We have 10 rural councillors with a vote and four other from the other district councils and one for other scheme employees. So it is weighted towards rural council. I think this proposal is to be a joint committee with equal representatives from each district council rather than 10 from rural.
With regards to option 4, I appreciate it's early days on this, but is there any special meaning in the words combined authority, or is it purely a description of an authority that has different elements in it? So is it separate from the currently existing combined authorities we see about?
I think it will be a separate entity. There's one pension fund that operates under this model, it's self-Yorkshire Pension Fund, and they operate under that model. It isn't actually the same constitution as a combined authority. So I think it will be subject to different legal entities of how that emerges. I don't know at this point in time.
Thanks, Chair.
Chair. I did miss the discussion, if you're aware, and I will be interested to see what the letter from the chair of the board does say, because certainly the issue of questioning teeth and the removal of the obligation for certain higher education and further education institutions to offer the scheme to new appointees is a matter of great concern. Firstly, from a trade union point of view, because it introduces the idea two-tier workforce in the important area of pensions. Secondly, it's extremely bad precedent to set. The government feels free to do this, and gets away with it, they could come back for more. I'm also concerned about the fact that the proposal only at the moment anyway only applies to England. So you'll get separate situations applying to LGPS members in Wales, Scotland and Northern Ireland. That would be a retrograde step. It also would represent over time a diminishing of fund income to all the funds in England, and I think that's a matter of regret, because we obviously need to be maintaining our cash flow, increasing it if possible, and not diminishing it. So I would hope that we could consider this further with the view of opposing that particular recommendation.
Thanks for that. Roger, those points are well made. As you've always said, all members will be circulated with comments in due course, and I would encourage everybody to respond to that with your point of view, so we can reach some conclusions on that before the deadline on the 31st of July.
Thank you, Chair.
Is that okay?
document is. We are the outlier of this, and it's essentially because of national legislation that forces us to this place. Many of us around the table may wish that we had a different fiscal regime, but it's not within our gift to do that unless and until tax legislation is changed. Then unfortunately we're going to have to do this, otherwise the fund and members will suffer because there will be less money coming in if we lose high value members to other schemes. So it's unfortunate, but I agree with the recommendation.
Yes. Thanks, Sean. Any other comments? Yeah. Okay. Thanks for that, Yvonne, and Julie noted particularly the resource indications under item 8. So the recommendations are that the committee is asked to approve the use of all the scheme pays in the circumstances outlined under section 13. Are we okay to approve?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much indeed. Thanks, Yvonne. Item 11 is systematic investment.
two areas. One was around the transition manager's ability to trade.
disclosable funds are part of the fund scheme of delegation and sets out the management and authorisation arrangements for the avoidance of doubt by organisations undertaking due diligence on MPF. Section 2.1 sets out the current approved signatories, and section 2.3 informs members that one signatory has changed their name unless the updated signatories accommodate the name change. So Yvonne Caddick is now known as Yvonne Murphy. The remainder of the section 2